Thank you. You know, I'm getting thirsty. But as a matter of fact, I'm always thirsty. And so is the whole band. And so, we like to propose a toast to the next song. It's called Bottoms Up.
Welcome, welcome. Before the passion, not the fashion, we are here with Vincent Lozen, one of the guys behind the Crash Bang Wallop compilation LP and CD. Welcome, Vincent.
Thank you, Marco.
First of all, I'd like to know who you are, and so please introduce yourself to our viewers.
Yeah, I'm a old school metalhead from the south of the Netherlands, and yeah, made a compilation together with my colleague Anton Doutzenberg, and we made a compilation on the early days of metal in Belgium and the Netherlands, and that means the really early days, so 1979, 1984. These were the period of the coming of age of heavy metal, but also our own coming of age. So that's what we actually celebrated with this compilation.
Oh, that's awesome! It's actually, I was born in 78 and started in 84 with heavy metal. So I was a little bit, joined the scene when this music was already released. But it's for me, yeah, it's for every classic heavy metal fan. I think the highlight of heavy metal was between the late 70s and the mid 80s. So, it's awesome. To continue about this, Robert Haagsma, yes. He recently released already the Dutch Steel compilation box set, and now you guys released the Crash Bang Wallop compilation on vinyl and box set. What's the main differences between the Dutch Steel compilation and the Crash Bang Wallop box set?
Now, the two main things, Robert did an amazing job, but that's really like a complete overview of Dutch metal, and it's also a longer period, and yes, like more tracks from say certain bigger bands, so it's more complete. We didn't aim to be complete, that was definitely not our aim. We also didn't use any track which is on the Dutch Steel, so there are some bands which are on both, but none of the tracks we used are on Dutch Steel. The big difference is, I think that we are Belgium, and we focused on Belgium and the Netherlands. The main reason is because the scene was so small, and we're living in the south of the Netherlands, so we were focused on both sides of the border.
Yes.
So we went. We went a lot of times to see live gigs in Belgium. And so for us, like Belgian bands and Dutch bands had the same impact. So I think that's also a main difference.
It's it's something I can find myself in. Yeah. I'm from Tilburg. So
yeah. So you're a little devil from the little.
Yeah. Yes. Yes. And only 5 kilometers to the border to Belgium. So yes. Anyway, personal I have only a regular vinyl and CD box set edition, which looks very nice. I can show you here. This is the LP version. with the soda back, and then the artwork inside. And this is the CD. I can show people too. And there's, you know, with a booklet in it and everything. Looks very decent, very cool. But there's also another edition, right? With a patch and a book and so.
Yeah, there's a very limited edition, which is a box set where the double vinyl is included together with a patch. I can show you.
It's yes.
It's this one. So it's
okay, cool.
The logo, Crash Bang Wallop. And there's also a booklet in it. The booklet is in Dutch, and it's designed. I can show you as well. It's designed as being like in those days they were very popular tour booklet.
Tour booklet, yeah, from the 80s and 90s, yeah.
Yeah, it's the size of an LP, and it's an 80 page booklet, and it has stories. On that period, interviews with bands, with promoters, with fans. It's very diverse, and I think it's a very good addition to the LP and to the music. But it's only in Dutch because it's like they are our personal experiences written down.
Mm-hmm.
So we thought it would be good to only do this in Dutch, and it's only in a very limited edition that it came out.
Because now you say it's only in Dutch, on one hand I can understand, but on the other hand, I have a lot of friends and know a lot of people from Brazil and stuff like countries like that,
yes.
And they are especially they are very hooked on. Belgian and Dutch bands like Picture of Acid, Set Iron, Vortex, they are very popular, especially in those countries.
Yeah.
In the South American
countries. Hey, they did invent Google Translate for
yeah,
a reason.
Okay. Hey, was it very difficult for you guys to hook up all the musicians and managers and labels, etc., to get permission and make this LP effect?
It was not difficult, but it took a while. I mean, it went slow.
Yeah.
So for a lot of these musicians, like a lot of these early recordings were, they either were lost, so there were no tapes anymore, or it wasn't clear to whom all the rights belonged. So it took a while, but it was not that difficult because everybody was enthusiastic. And I think we had like two of the bands took us a bit longer to find out who was the owner of the rights, because some of these record companies already were broke after like 4 or 5 years. So it was not clear
who owns the rights. And what can you tell us about Arjan Lucas's early published tracks on this collector's item?
Yeah, it's a song by his first band called Mover.
Mover,
and, yeah, and they never released anything. Arjan got a like cassette tape from the bass player in the band, and he still had that. And then Arjan said when we did an interview for the book, we did an interview with him, and he told us that he still had the tape. And that if we thought it would be good to release this, then he could ask it was like a simple cassette, and so we did, and it was I think a very interesting track. It's a bit like an early 70s band, The Sweet meets Black Sabbath. That was what I would call the kind of song it is. And Arjan himself was very enthusiastic about the fact that we finally, after all these 40 years, there was a track released from his first band. And it's a band he had with an Israeli singer, Shmulek Havigal.
A great singer for Horizon and Picture.
Yeah, Picture, Horizon and Hammerhead. And so he actually came to the Netherlands to join this band. He had a Dutch girlfriend. And then when he tried to live with her, he was looking for a band to sing in. And that's how he teamed up with Mover. And and it's it's a very collectible thing because they never released a song before. So after 40 years, there's the first Arjen Lucas song ever.
Awesome. And I also saw a very rare name. This is a band called Victim on this compilation. I owned the demos on the CDR for years. I thought this band was from Turnhout, right?
They were from the Belgian Kempen.
Yes. So
that's, Turnhout and surroundings.
Yeah, I was very surprised that you choose for this band because I thought I was one of the only ones who were familiar with this band. But I think I know why, because they're very old bands, right?
They existed actually already before the new wave of British heavy metal came ashore in the Netherlands and Belgium. So they made a kind of status quo kind of rock before.
Yeah.
And they had two singles released and they had got some airplay. And then they evolved in a more heavy metal band with some classic hard rock influences. So I think the song we choose was a song you could say, I think we describe it as being Uriah Heep teaming up with Paul Di'Anno.
Yeah.
So it has this organ vibe in it, but it's quite heavy and it's a punky style of singing by the singer. And the band, they recorded this demo for Mausoleum Records, and they were supposed to release their first full album, but then Mausoleum got broke, and so it never got released. So that was a 7-track demo they did, and this is one of the songs on that. I think the more heavy song. So we really liked it, and we got it from the singer of the band who owned the rights, and he gave it to us.
Awesome. Because about this band, Victim, it was really I was really surprised when I found this out, and I think people need to hear it.
I think it's a great song too.
Hey, and the illustration are provided by Maarten Donders, who works also for Opeth. And he did for the Dutch Roadburn Festival in Tilburg.
Yeah.
How did you find this guy, and how are you happy with this result from designing?
Yeah, I think he's in the scene, especially in that scene around Roadburn.
Mm-hmm. Stoner
scene. He is a big name, and I think he's a fabulous artist. So we were really lucky that he agreed to help us out with this. And I think he did a very, very cool work because, I mean, he's a bit younger. And so for us, it was important that you could feel the vibe of these early 80s heavy metal design as well. And I think he did that really, really, really good.
Mm-hmm.
So it's all hand-drawn. So he painted, there's a painting in the middle of the album, which is like a classic... I would say, you know, with skulls and dragons, etc., fire. So it's like a classic image, and also the album itself, the backside, it's really typical 80s, and the logo itself. So we were very pleased. And Martin himself, he lives in Paris, we had only contact in these Corona days. Via Skype, and he got the vibe straight away. So we're really, really pleased with the artwork.
Cool. And I want to ask your opinion about the main difference between the bands from Belgium and the Netherlands. I have my opinion, but I'm curious about yours.
Yeah, my opinion is that in the beginning, I mean, as a kid, we didn't realize that difference. You know, we went to see a band like Killer, and for us, I mean, I'm even not sure that I knew that it was a Belgian band and not a Dutch band. But I think the main difference, if you, in hindsight, that if you look back, then it's maybe the Belgian bands are a bit more adventurous. I think especially if we just talked about design, the design of all the bands that signed on the label Mausoleum, which was an important label in those days,
which was
a Belgian label. And what they did, they signed Belgian bands, because in Holland you had two labels, Roadrunner and Ravon, but they mainly signed foreign bands. So the Belgians had maybe a bit earlier a chance to release their albums. And I think they were a bit more adventurous, if I listen back to it. So we were maybe in the Netherlands, since I'm Dutch, were maybe a bit like more hooked on the classic bluesy rock of hard rock, and like a band, you're wearing a t-shirt of Acid. A band like Acid, I mean, they made speed metal before we knew the terms.
And female fronted before
female fronted. There was no female fronted band. You know, you had these American bands like Joan Jett and Heart, etc.
In England, a bit.
Yeah, in England, you had Girl School. But I mean, a really heavy band, like speed metal band with a female singer. It I can't name another one.
Acid was the first female fronted heavy metal band in the Benelux, I think, and even before Germany, I think. Doro came after.
Doro released on Mausoleum on the Belgian, Warlock.
And
that was later. So that was more than a year later after the second release of Acid. So she definitely was the first on the European mainland. And then you can discuss that, like Wendy O. Williams of the Plasmatics. Maybe she was before, and that was really heavy. That was more punky. So, in my opinion, that was no heavy metal.
And what I see as a big difference between the scenes in both countries, I think in Holland there's a big difference between the bands from the Northeast and the North, who are quite heavy and quite cult, like Set Iron, Vortex, Emerald, stuff like this, and a Dark Wizard. And in the south, they were more melodic, like Vengeance and Bodine and stuff. Bodine were from the south, from the middle of the country. But those bands here were more like on the melodic way, touch. And in Belgium, you had many bands who sounded like Motorhead, you know, very raw stuff.
That's true.
That's also big differences between the bands, I think, especially at least. But a band like Ostrogoth was melodic as well, you know. So,
yeah.
I know there was a lot of talent around over here in the Netherlands, and you just mentioned it already. The record companies and the Dutch press was always, the Dutch people were always looking on America, England, and they never looked what was coming from near. That's my opinion about the Dutch metal scene. There's always what's coming from far is better, and that's a thing I always think it's sad, you know, because there's so many talent here in the Netherlands, and why do you think it was so hard for Dutch and also Belgian bands to make it worldwide back then, and what's your thought about it?
Yeah, I think it's like a natural way. If there is a new scene, they have to they have to develop them. And so in the beginning, it was like also a matter of quality, recording quality, support, like you mentioned. I mean, I in those days, as a young kid, where we were organizing gigs as well, and if we could choose about organizing a gig from a band from the UK like Satan or Picture from the Netherlands, I'm sure that we were going for Satan first, because that was something you couldn't see every week.
Yes.
And Picture you could see everywhere. Next to that, I think the development of the live scene, and I mean the club circuit like we know it now, and that didn't exist, so it had to start up. So it took some time. So they didn't get the same chances as a lot of these foreign bands, and there weren't I mean, there weren't that much bands. I mean, now we know a lot of them, but in those days, if you had like 15 Dutch heavy metal bands, proper heavy metal bands, that was it. And we were, when I was listening back to make a selection, which is always very difficult, there were some bands I thought were really good in my opinion. And then I heard them back after 40 years and I thought, oh, this is poor. And other ones were like, Jesus, this is good. You know, this is original. So it's just a matter of the time you need, I think, to build a scene.
Yeah, I can agree. And I think it's also, I see it around me, you know, when I come with Dutch bands around, people always like, yeah, let's see. And if it's from, but also from other counties, especially the counties America or UK, then people are mostly very excited already, quick excited about. And what's coming from more obscure countries or smaller counties, it's always hard, I think.
Yeah, but you see, I mean, there's some of these tracks on our album which are really, really good and also even well produced. And they didn't have any budget, you know. It's like a band like Killer, they recorded their first albums at night, you know, in the studio when the studio time was they couldn't afford to pay proper studio time. So they did like four nights in a row and then they recorded an album. And if you listen back to it, it sounds really good, you know.
And what makes Benelux metal from the late 70s and early 80s special, and why?
Yeah, for us there are a few things. It's also nostalgic. To be clear about that. So if you think back at the good times when you're a young kid, discovering the world and discovering yourself. That's part of it. But I also think they were early, so they could make mistakes. You know, they didn't. There were no formats. There were no subgenres, so you didn't have to choose. You could on the same record do something very speedy or dark, and something more poppy. I mean, nowadays you wouldn't do that. But then they could afford it, and I think it's that makes it interesting. And they were just you know, behind the wave for which was coming from the UK. So they were really, really fast. Say within months, there was an answer from Belgium to Iron Maiden. I would say, you know, that was interesting as well. They could play with these big bands. So there were not that much bands. So if Iron Maiden would do a show over here, I mean, a Dutch band or a Belgian band could open for them and do a double bill. And I mean, it was just the beginning, you know, before the big wave and these bands. Like Metallica was a small band by then, and everybody was very enthusiastic. So they became a big band really, really rapidly. Mm-hmm. You know, these first 2 years, so 1.5 year, 83, 84, it was not a big band.
No,
but it did very small shows actually.
It's also what you're saying about mixing all those things together. I remember, and I'm younger than you guys. I remember that we are hard rockers. And we had no black metal guys, death metal guys. We're all hard rockers. Yeah. If we listen to Metallica, Bon Jovi, or Slayer, or Judas Priest, we're all hard rockers.
Yeah.
That was, that's one word, hard rockers.
Yeah, that's how it started, huh?
Yeah.
I still like that. I like that too. That it's widespread and it's all, belong to the same people, you know. We went to see a show, for instance, in, I remember very well in Karlshövel.
Earthquake.
The Earthquake Festival. And so you had like heavy bands and Europe on the same stage.
Europe was cancelled, huh?
No. Europe, they played the...
played?
The second year or the third year. The second year, I think.
I thought it was cancelled, Europe, and came another band. No, they were on the bill.
They were on the bill. I've seen them. I'm not sure whether it was Earthquake, to be honest, but I think it was Earthquake. But I do remember that we were proud when Europe came a big band, because that was part of our, say, legacy as well. That's how we looked at it.
And it was just after the Earthquake Festival, because before the Earthquake Festival, they played more heavy, and with the Final Countdown, of course, they break through, and that was a more like a glammy pop metal album, of course. You also had talks with Kate from Acid, which is a good friend of mine, by the way. Hi, Kate, if you see this. And Hanneke Kappe from the radio program show Stampai. Yeah. How special were women in heavy metal back in those days?
There were definitely less women than men. Hanneke, she had a rock band herself.
I didn't know that.
She was a singer of a band called White Honey. And she did a radio show. White Honey was no heavy metal, even not hard rock. I think it was a decent rock band. And she was, I think, very adventurous, this show. So it was on what we would now would call Radio 3. So it was like the main pop channel. And they had, in those days, they had two of these rock shows. In the late afternoon on a Wednesday, I think, and so she was like, for us, was a symbol, because I mean, that it was an hour of discovering new bands, that was like, it was a voice. She still has a fantastic voice, so for us it was also the voice, but definitely the music they played. And for female singers, yeah, that was like Kate, that was really something new. That was something we didn't know by then. I mean,
groundbreaking.
Yeah, that was groundbreaking.
And if you would say there's a big four of metal acts in the Netherlands and Belgium, what should that big four be? Which band would you mention the big four?
Yeah, I think it's a bit difficult, because I mean, if you talk about big four, do you talk about quality, about popularity?
Popularity, about impact, I think in general, like Metallica and Anthrax and so on.
Yeah, then I would mention Killer and Ostrogoth, or Killer and Acid. That's a bit, in the Netherlands, I would say, for me personally, it would be Picture and Bodine. Because they were like really early bands, and you can't compare them. I mean, it's a Picture is a bit more raw and a bit, a bit direct, cold.
Yeah.
And Bodine is a bit more bluesy and warm. But I think these four bands would, I think. I never thought about it like that, but if you ask it, I would say these are maybe probably the big four.
Yeah, I can find myself in this, but I also, you talked about, we talked about Arjan Lucas before, who was in Mover, but to be clear for the people who are not so familiar with Dutch heavy metal, he was also in Bodine.
Yeah, he was in Bodine, and he was... Vengeance,
yeah, which is a great band from our area, Tilburg area, yeah. Great band. One of the greatest too, but they started in 83 or 84, so they were not part of the first move.
Lucas left Bodine.
Yes.
He went to join Vengeance, and then I think he moved from the, because then he still lived in The Hague, he moved from The Hague to Brabant.
Yes.
Inventions. Yeah.
And my final question is, how can the fans of old school Benelux get this masterpiece, and why do you recommend the Headbangers to buy this collector's box set?
I mean, they can get it in every proper record store and online, even worldwide. So it's available from Japan to Finland to England. So maybe they have to ask the local record store, because I'm in favor of buying it physical in a record store, to be honest.
Yeah, it's
cool. But you can find it online as well. And if you want to buy the box, you have to hurry up because it's really limited. And why they should buy it, if they have, they want to, if they know this area, if they lived through this area, it's a nice nostalgic trip. Mm-hmm. And if they didn't, it's really interesting to discover where it all came from. So these are the basics and the roots of heavy metal in Belgium and the Netherlands.
Yeah,
nice. Must be reason enough.
Yeah, yeah. And you mentioned in the very beginning, like, we are from the border area, you and me, and we also focused very much on both countries. Like, I go now Friday to a candle mass in Antwerp, and you know, this kind of things, going mm-hmm. often to Belgium, go off in Netherlands, Germany too. Germany is not far either, so we are very focused on especially these countries. And if you are from the northeast, and the north is completely far away, you know, so mm-hmm. that's why you choose probably for a compilation for the people here, especially. This is very interesting for the people from the border areas. I think that's the most.
Yeah, but it's also these Dutch bands and Belgian bands that first, if they noticed they had a bit of success.
Yeah,
it was like, we can play in Belgium for a Dutch band, or a Belgian band said, yeah, we can go and play in Geleen, or we can go and play in Tilburg.
Yeah,
so that was like the first sign of success as well.
And, international success.
Yeah, in a small base. Yeah. So and if you live in where we live in the south, it's a longer ride to Amsterdam than it is to Brussels or to Cologne.
And to be honest, the beer and the food is cheaper in Belgium and Germany than in the central. And better, yeah. So I also prefer to go out abroad. But sorry, Amsterdam. Sorry, Rotterdam. Sorry, but yeah, I love it too to go up. Belgium is a great country, and I feel my second country. You know, yesterday I went for a sandwich, 5 kilometers, go tanking by the border, eat a sandwich, drink a Jupiler, and drive back. You know, that's.
And which music did you play on the radio?
Well, we played Autograph.
Okay.
I remember we played Autograph. Anyway, not a Dutch band, American band, but anyway.
Yeah.
Hey, thank you very much for this chat.
Thank you.
I was very pleased when they shipped this CD and this Theo shipped me this CD and this vinyl. Yeah.
And this is the book, huh?
This is the book, which is not in this one because I don't have the collector's item. I have a collector's item, but not the most like you have.
It's not the box. I mean, it's
not the box, not the box set. But I want to tell everybody, give attention to our great scenes from Belgium and the Netherlands. And thank you very much for keeping the spirit alive to show the world that we were something too here in the Netherlands and Belgium. And check out my channel and my YouTube. We have also written a review, a written review on our e-zine. So I send it to you after the show.
That's cool.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Thanks for watching.
Marco, thank you.
Like, share, subscribe now. And well, good luck with your with the selling and the distribution of your collector of your great box set and LP.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much.
Bye-bye.